It's been said that everything biological is psychological, and everything psychological is biological. While that may sound like a little bit of a brain teaser, it actually is a great way of thinking about just how interconnected your mind and body actually are. That connection is the topic of this video. Hi everybody, and thank you for watching. Today's video is going to be an overview of biopsychology. So we're going to be talking a lot about the biological influences on your behavior and mental functions. Now remember, with my overview videos, I provide you with a general review of the topic. If you need to explore or review more specific topics, then make sure you watch the detailed micro-learning videos on those topics. You can find links for those videos below. Let's start talking about biopsychology by talking a little bit about genetic influences. Now, these videos are definitely meant for students taking a general psychology course, so I don't want to spend too much time talking about chromosomes and DNA and genes. However, I did want to point out that just like we have a genetic basis for something like our skin color, hair color, height, and whether or not we're prone to certain medical conditions, we also have those same genetic influences psychologically. These influences can lead to some people being more prone to psychological disorders like schizophrenia, major depressive disorder, bipolar disorder, and many others. They can also lead to people being more prone to just anxiety or depression overall. What is surprising to many people is that some studies have even suggested connections between personality traits in your genes. One of the big differences, though, between genetic influences of most physical characteristics compared to psychological ones goes back to a concept we talked about before. If you remember in the video I did on the biopsychosocial perspective, I mentioned how you are what you are today because of the result of your biology, but also because of life events and psychological factors that shaped you becoming the person you are. The way I like to think about it is like when you're born, you're given a lump of clay. Some of us get more than others. Some of us get different colors or different types of clay. Throughout our life, the clay itself doesn't change. However, how we mold and shape that clay plays a huge role in what the clay ultimately ends up becoming. So someone with, say, problems with anxiety may have a genetic predisposition to anxiety, but they also probably have developed psychological and social habits that help that genetic predisposition become worse. This is one of the reasons why it's important to treat people with psychological problems with counseling, even if they're also taking medication for that problem. Yes, your genes play a big role, but you also can change your own biology through your actions, thoughts, perspectives, and even behaviors. This is why I started out this video with talking about how everything biological is psychological and vice versa. We'll talk about this topic again when we explore psychological disorders and talk about something called the diathesis stress model. Since this video is about biopsychology, a large part of what I'm going to be talking about is directly related to the nervous system. The nervous system includes structures of your brain and spinal cord, but also nerves that connect out from those structures to all parts of your body. So although most people think of the nervous system just as being your brain, it's important to remember that it actually is present in virtually all parts of your body, not just your brain. The nervous system is divided up into a couple different subsystems or divisions. The first division is between the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system. The central nervous system includes your brain and spinal cord. The peripheral nervous system includes all the nerves that branch off from your brain and spinal cord and connect throughout your body. These include sensory cells that are responsible for us being able to see, smell, taste, feel pain or heat, and so much more. The central nervous system is not subdivided anymore, but the peripheral nervous system is. It's divided up into the autonomic and the somatic nervous systems. The autonomic nervous system is automatic. It includes all those things that our bodies do that we aren't really consciously aware of or usually in control of. This includes things like our heartbeat. The somatic nervous system includes those things that we are in control of and aware of, things like walking or talking. The somatic nervous system isn't subdivided anymore, but the autonomic is. The autonomic nervous system is further subdivided into the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems. The sympathetic is responsible for your body's fight or flight response, and the parasympathetic is responsible for your body's rest and relax response. I go into a little greater detail about these subsystems and your body's fight or flight response in another video. To understand how your nervous system works, we need to dig deeper than just the divisions of the nervous system and look at the cells that work together to make the nervous system function the way it does. There are two main types of cells in the nervous system, neurons and glial cells. Neurons have the primary role of relaying information throughout the nervous system and from the nervous system to other parts of the body. Glial cells have more of a supportive role to neurons. There are specialized glial cells that help provide support and protection to the nervous system. Some even work almost like the garbage men of the nervous system, removing waste products. You even have some that work to help insulate the neurons so that they are better able to work in the most efficient way possible. I like to think of glial cells as being like the backup dancers, and neurons are like the rock stars. Although you can hear different reports of the number, it's generally accepted that there are roughly 100 billion neurons and an equal number of glial cells throughout your nervous system. When you think about it, that's really amazing that just one part of your body, the nervous system, has nearly 200 billion cells in it. Now, there are many different types of both glial cells and neurons. However, since this is just a general overview video meant for a general psychology course, I'm not going to go into detail as far as the different types of cells that do exist. I do go into greater detail about the components of the neurons in another video that you can check out in the link below. The important thing to remember is that neurons are responsible for releasing chemicals to other neurons that trigger them and are responsible for certain specific functions within the nervous system and throughout the body. These chemical messengers, known as neurotransmitters, are hugely important in our discussion of biopsychology because they affect certain functions that are critical for how our brains and bodies work. I also discuss some of the different types of neurotransmitters in a separate video, so make sure you check that one out too. All of these cells, neurons and glial cells, form an interconnected web of structures that constitute your brain. Often, people think of your brain as being a solid object, but it actually is composed of many different structures. In fact, you can kind of think of your brain as being similar to an onion. It has many different layers, and each of those layers have different areas that specialize in certain functions. We like to say in psychology that function is localized. That means that there are locations in the brain responsible for a whole host of specific functions. However, you also need to remember that virtually nothing your brain or body does only involves one part. Think of something simple and easy, at least for most of us, like walking. Walking involves several parts of your brain working in concert with one another to make it happen. You have parts of your brain involved in coordination, balance, muscle movement, and even things like coordinating your vision with your walking so that you don't trip on something in your path. There are specific parts of your brain responsible for all these functions, but it's how they work together that makes the activity possible. And keep in mind that your brain is doing activities like these, all while also making sure your immune system is functioning, heart is beating, breathing is occurring, and a whole host of other functions that we aren't really even aware of. It really is an amazing part of our bodies, and one that is still in many ways not fully understood. By now you probably know what I'm about to say. Yes, if you want to learn more information about the different parts of the brain, check out the video I did on the structures of your brain, and you can see the link below. Much of the new information we've learned about how the brain works is directly the result of some of the huge advances in imaging techniques that have been discovered over the past few decades. These imaging techniques include things like CT scans, PET scans, and MRIs. CT scan stands for computerized tomography. A CT scan uses X-rays to detect differences in brain density. It can give an image of the brain, but it's kind of a basic image. CT scans are usually used to diagnose things like brain tumors because the tumor will have a different density than the surrounding brain tissue. A PET scan stands for positron emission tomography. Typically, the way it is conducted is that a person is injected with a very mildly radioactive substance called a tracer. That goes into their bloodstream. A scan is then done of the brain to follow where that tracer goes. Essentially, the more active parts of your brain are, the more blood they'll use, and the more of the tracer will appear in a specific area of the brain. This appears on the scan as being a brighter colored region compared to the surrounding parts of the brain. PET scans also don't give a really good image of specific structures of the brain. However, they do show how active different parts of the brain are. Oftentimes, you can see where a PET scan will be used along with a CT scan. Probably the one type of brain imaging technique that is considered the gold standard today would be the MRI, which stands for magnetic resonance imaging. Without going into too much detail about biochemistry, what happens with an MRI is that your brain is exposed to a magnetic field. The different chemical molecules in parts of your brain respond to this magnetic field, and the differences in how they react is able to be tracked. This allows for the possibility of an extremely detailed image of the brain. A specific type of MRI called a functional MRI or fMRI can also be used not just to show brain structures, but also show activity within the brain, kind of similar to what a PET scan does. A lot of times with psychological research, an fMRI may be used to compare, say, the brains of individuals with a disorder like schizophrenia or bipolar disorder with individuals that do not have a psychological disorder as a way of comparing the different ways their brains function. All of these imaging techniques I mentioned do have some drawbacks. The first is that they tend to be expensive and have to be performed in a doctor's office or a hospital type setting. The person getting the technique also is largely immobilized while the test is being performed. For these reasons, one of the most commonly used techniques for measuring brain activity in psychology is a technique called electroencephalography, or EEG. This test involves probes being placed at various parts around a person's head in order to measure the electrical activity within the brain. So basically, parts of the brain that are working harder will have more electrical activity than parts of the brain that are not working as hard. The big benefit to an EEG is that a person is able to wear these probes and still have a lot of movement. So we can do things like do an EEG while a person is actually engaging in activities. That way we can see the brain actually working while a person is studying or working on a computer or driving a car or any of a variety of different types of actions. Hopefully all this has piqued your interest a little bit about our nervous system. And if it has, please definitely check out some of the other videos I did in greater detail about certain topics within the nervous system. The links for those videos are located below. Thanks for watching, everybody.